In the next several lectures, we're going to begin our discussion on the process of protein synthesis, also known as translation. Now, recall that DNA molecules, although they do carry and store the genetic information that is needed for protein synthesis, the DNA molecules themselves are not actually directly involved in protein synthesis. So what happens is the genetic information that is stored in DNA is transferred, is passed down to RNA molecules, and it's the RNA molecules that are directly involved in protein synthesis that takes place in the cytoplasm of the cell. Now remember, there are three different types of RNA molecules that we should be aware of, and each one of these RNA molecules serves its own specific function. Now let's recall what these RNA molecules are and what their function is. And let's begin with the messenger RNA. So the messenger RNA, also known as the mRNA, is basically the molecule that carries the genetic information from the nucleus into the cytoplasm of the cell. And it's the mRNA molecule that is used as a template by the ribosomes to synthesize our polypeptide chain, our protein. Now, the second type of RNA molecule that we should be aware of is the ribosomal RNA, or rRNA. Now, rRNA is synthesized in the nucleolus of the nucleus of the cell, and once synthesized, it travels into the cytoplasm through the nuclear pores of the nuclear membrane of the cell. Now, basically, the rRNA is itself a constituent of the ribosome. So ribosomes are composed of proteins as well as rRNA. And the final type of RNA molecule that we should be aware of is transfer RNA, or tRNA. So tRNA is also synthesized in the nucleus, and the function of tRNA is to basically collect and bring the proper amino acids from the cytoplasm and into the ribosomes, so the ribosomes can use those amino acids to synthesize the polypeptide chain. Now, before we actually examine the process of translation, let's discuss what ribosomes actually are and what they consist of. So translation, or the process of protein synthesis, basically involves these special cell machineries known as ribosomes. And any given ribosome itself consists of a small unit and a large unit. So we have the small subunit and a large subunit. So together, a ribosome consists of two subunits. Now, these subunits are basically composed of proteins as well as rRNA molecules. So the rRNA molecules are created within the nucleolus, and then they are brought into the cytoplasm. And in the cytoplasm, as we'll see in just a moment, the two subunits, the large and the small subunits, combine with our mRNA to form our ribosome. Now, both prokaryotic and eukaryotic organisms contain ribosomes, but in eukaryotic and prokaryotic organisms, our ribosomes are slightly different. So they consist of slightly different small and large subunits. So let's take a look at the differences between our subunits. So let's begin with eukaryotic organisms. So in eukaryotes, our small subunit is the 40S, while the large subunit is the 60S, and they combine to form a unit known as the 80S unit. Now, in prokaryotic organisms, the small subunit is the 30S, and the large subunit is the 50S, and they combine to form the 70S unit. Now, the question that you might be asking is, what exactly is the S? What does the S actually stand for? Well, S basically stands for the Svedberg unit, and this is basically a unit that measures the rate at which the given particle or molecule, in this case our subunit, sediments. So the Svedberg unit usually refers to how quickly something sediments or travels along or down a test tube that is basically rotating with some angular velocity. And the Svedberg unit is directly related to the mass of our particle, and it also depends on the size and the shape of the molecule. So heavier molecules will be found farther down the test tube than lighter molecules. So we see that the larger subunits, the 60S and the 50S, will be found farther down our test tube than the 40S and the 30S, because the 60S and 50S are basically heavier molecules. Now, what exactly is the purpose of these small and large subunits? Well, basically, before our translation actually takes place, the small and the large subunits are separated. They only come together during the process of translation, as we'll see in just a moment. And the purpose of our ribosome, so basically the large and the small subunit combine to form the ribosome, and the purpose of the ribosome is to basically translate the sequence of nucleotides into the proper sequence of amino acids. And this is exactly what we mean by translation. So the ribosomes basically translate the language of the mRNA into the language of our protein, and thereby synthesize our proteins by using our genetic code. So now, our process of translation can be broken down into three stages. We have the initiation stage, we have the elongation stage, and the termination stage. In this lecture, we're only going to focus on our initiation stage. So once our precursor mRNA or pre-RNA actually undergoes the proper post-transcriptional modifications in the nucleus, it basically becomes the mRNA, and it leaves the nucleus via the nuclear pores. Now, once it enters the cytoplasm, special types of proteins that are known as initiation factors basically help the mRNA find the small subunit, and the small subunit binds to the 5 end of our mRNA. And once the small subunit binds to our 5 end, it begins to travel along our mRNA until it locates a specific sequence of nucleotides that is known as the start codon. And this sequence is beginning with the 5 end, A, U, G, and ending with our 3 end. So basically, this is described in the following diagram. So once our mRNA is inside the nucleus, a set of proteins known as initiation factors help our small subunit locate the 5 end of our mRNA. And once it binds, it travels along our mRNA until it locates our start codon, the sequence AUG. And once it locates the AUG sequence, our small subunit basically tells its signals, a tRNA molecule, to go out and find a methionine molecule. And it brings our tRNA brings that methionine molecule to our AUG. So this is our tRNA molecule. It contains the complementary sequence to our AUG. So if this is the 5 end and this is the 3 end, we have AUG, then this is the 3 end, UAC, and this is the 5 end. And so once our small subunit locates the start codon, this basically goes out and finds our methionine, which is shown in orange, and then it brings our methionine to this location. And once our tRNA combines with this region, our large subunit also combines with the small subunit, and so we form our ribosome molecule. And And this concludes the process of initiation. And the site, the location of our tRNA molecule inside the ribosome is known as the P site. In the next lecture, we're going to discuss the next stage known as elongation and the final stage known as termination. And we'll see that there are two other important sites that exist inside our ribosome known as the A site as well as our E site. So we see that the process of translation involves three types of RNA molecules. We have mRNA, tRNA, and rRNA. And basically what happens during the first stage of translation is our mRNA locates our small subunit, which then basically finds our AUG start codon sequence. And once it finds, it signals a tRNA to pick up the methionine amino acid and bring it into our small subunit. And once that binding takes place, it signals the large subunits shown here. So this is the small, this is the large unit. It tells the large subunit to basically attach to the small subunit, and that forms the ribosome, and that concludes the process of initiation.